I think just probably being around Andrew singing, my scales, my interest in music, our talking about it, inspired him probably in some way to write for this kind of voice. I don't think he'd written really for sopranos before.
The smitten composer was determined to make his new wife a big star, and Phantom of the Opera provided the perfect opportunity.
I just wanted to write a high romance. I hadn't had an opportunity, hadn't found a subject before, which I thought I could do that, and there it was.
With his muse by his side, Lloyd Webber set to work writing the score of his life.
I was around to try things out with him, for him to see where the voice would go, where it was comfortable, what would sound perfect with the soprano voice.
I mean, wishing you were somehow here again. I mean, that was a so simple, that, you know. And that's, I mean, again, all I ask of you. I always like that tune because it's the only melody that I've ever written, and in fact the only melody I know which has got a major ninth in it. I love that. You've got the opportunity to write the love duet of all time if you can. You know, that was what I set out to do.
He must have kind of spotted that this story about the composer and the young soprano must have had resonances for him.
I am your angel of music.
He was writing for the woman he absolutely loved, with a voice that was so right, and what Gaston Leroux imagined in his book.
Angel, I hear you speak, I listen.
She is the muse of his music in this show, and that is what the story is about.
Angel, my soul was weak, forgive me, enter at last, master.
It felt like me. I mean, the part was for a girl who had trained as a dancer, she had a wonderful voice, she wanted to get on in life, and that's really how it was for me.
Lloyd Webber's attempt to boost his wife's career made them an easy target for ridicule.
Everyone was gunning for her, and she'd really done nothing. It wasn't as though she had a track record.
I have heard the charge of nepotism levelled at you because of Sarah, your wife.
No, I think that, you see, somebody in my position, as you say, has got to be very, very careful. I have to honestly choose the best person who I think for a particular role.
To give his show, with his wife, a fighting chance, Lloyd Webber turned to one of the giants of musical theatre.
The more eyes you can lock within the orchestra, in the stalls, the more people you can get on the front row of it.
Broadway director Hal Prince already had a catalogue of hit shows: Cabaret, West Side Story, Sweeney Todd, and Lloyd Webber's own Evita.
I happened to run into Hal Prince at an evening drinks thing for the Tony Awards that I went to that night.
And he said, I have an idea for a musical, I don't know. I said, what is it? And he said, Phantom of the Opera. And I said, do it. And he said, will you do it? And I said, yes, I'll do it. I'm sure. I don't usually do that. I'm usually a bit more cautious. This just seemed like the right idea. And the reason it seemed like the right idea to me and to him was that it was romantic, intensely romantic.
The producers needed to raise £2 million to bring Phantom to the stage. Lloyd Webber decided to try out a rough version of it before his pals invited to the annual music festival at his country house, Sidmonton. Richard Stilgoe, the lyricist of Starlight Express, was hired to write the words.
Andrew has a house in the country with a little theatre in a little church on the lawn, which everyone should have. It's a very convenient way of trying stuff out. And we wrote the first act of Phantom, and then Andrew's idea is always that it's then tried out in front of a cross-section of the public, which is, of course, complete tosh.
And I remember Andrew saying to me, well, I'll do a lousy impression of Andrew now. Well done, I think it'd be a good idea to get a few mates over the house and and see, you know, get a reaction. So I said, who are you thinking of? And he said, well, Margaret Thatcher, Geoffrey Howe, David Frost, David Meller, and he went on like this. And I said, well, what good will that do, Andrew? And he said, well, we'll find out what Joe Public thinks of it.
Sarah played Christine, the role written for her. And the phantom stand-in was the celebrated tenor Colm Wilkinson.
I said, I do feel that Phantom doesn't have a solo song to sing in Act One. We need to find something.
Andrew added a song called Married Man at the end with a tune that went dee-dum, da-dum, da-da-da-da, dee-dum. And that became Music of the Night.
It was amazing to see the show actually come to life, but it wasn't brilliant. People said, yes, it's good. Yeah. Do you know where I can get a drink?
The festival threw up what, as it normally does, what was right and what was wrong. And what was wrong, I think, was the slightly jokey approach to the whole thing.
I refused to go to Sidmonton to see it. I don't want to do that. I looked at the tape and the audience was roaring from beginning to end, and I thought, that's not what we want. That's not what I want. I didn't want anything camp.
I saw a video of the Sidmonton production quite recently, and I was quite ashamed of what rubbish some of the words were. All I Ask of You had the words All I Ask of You, which were nice, and everything else was just awful. I mean, really, really deep guilt.
I could bring you flowers to mingle with your hair, but what good would be flowers? They only love.
But one mate was impressed enough to part with his cash.
With Phantom, I thought, worth a punt. Put in 5,000, which I suppose 20 years ago must have been quite a reasonable sum of money. That would be equivalent to, I don't know, 25,000, 30,000 now. So obviously I felt it was going to do well.
Sidmonton had used simple miniature sets. Transforming the show into a lavish West End musical fell to the late Maria Bjornson. But the opera designer had never worked in mainstream theatre before.
I'd quite like to be a shiny black that's actually quite reflective, and to mix velvet with a shine.
Sure. Maria was a crazy genius, really. She was tough to work for. She was always tearing her hair out about some terrible detail that wasn't going right. But you put up with it all because you knew the final product was going to be amazing.
The crazy genius and her assistant were facing one of the biggest challenges of their careers. Their task was to recreate the Phantom's original home, the majestic Paris Opera House.
I came here in late November 85, and there was a sprinkling of snow outside. And we came here really to get the spirit of the building. We took hundreds of photographs. We went all the way down to the basement and up to the roof. We spent a lot of time here on the staircase because obviously it's a prominent feature of the show.